on March 10th, 2016, after 4 years of planning, 14 men left Cape Town, South Africa, bound for one of the most isolated islands in the world. Their purpose was to establish advanced communications and make observations of the changes wrought by global warming. Their destination was Heard Island, deep in the Southern Ocean, practically to Antarctica. The team spent 3 weeks on the island, the first to explore a new lake created by the melting of a large glacier. They returned with 25,000 photographs, 75,000 radio contacts, and a large collection of biological and geological specimens. The project was formally known as the 2016 Cordell Expedition to Heard Island, but it is also known by its radio call sign, Victor Kilowatt Zero, Echo Kilowatt. Eleven days after leaving Cape Town, we arrive at Heard Island with a characteristic chaotic sea, but an uncharacteristic visibility of several miles. It's hard to keep our eyes and our cameras off of Mawson Peak, 9,000 feet high above us. Now and then, it was smoking. Sometimes the best view was from the water. With the main vessel at anchor, we used the shuttlecraft to ferry equipment, supplies, and personnel to the campsite on shore. It took about 50 trips, all done in one day. The ATV and wagons were essential to transport our equipment and supplies from the beach to our campsite. Even the personnel got a lift. Every few hours, we were able to make a telephone call to an automatic recorder to explain what we were doing at that particular moment.
This is Bob. It is now 11 minutes left to 6. We have landed on Heard Island. We are standing at the essential site of our campsite at Atlas Cove. We had an incredibly beautiful and gentle weather situation when we arrived. We are now looking at this pivot. Yesterday to a spectacular landing day. There was visibility to the horizon to the north. All of the Lawrence Peninsula was visible and was alternately partially covered with fog with sunlight behind it.
The two main shelters were laid out on the ground and anchored firmly. Then an air compressor simply inflated them within about 15 minutes each. Once inflated, they were ready for occupancy. The king penguins were attracted to our sandbags, which I guess resembled other penguins to them. Once the shelters and the main facilities were in place, we started erecting the radio antennas. The ruins of the Australian research expedition from 50 years earlier was a constant reminder that history plays out only one way. Much of the exploration of Heard Island was done by simply walking and recording the environment using high-resolution still photographs and video. On the northwest corner of Heard Island, the Lawrence Peninsula has a large bay in which we found a very small islet, which was a rock 100 feet or so across that had broken loose from the coast and slowly drifted outward into the sea. We approached this from the side and found that it was constructed of columnar jointing, not uncommon. From above, we were able to see the top of it and some very mysterious features near the top. These array of plugs here was a mystery until finally we learned that it was nests of the blue-eyed cormorant. Southern elephant seals are the largest of all seals in the world. Males can be 20 feet long, weigh almost 9,000 pounds. But we found only females on Heard Island because the males were elsewhere at that time. They spend a fair amount of their time play fighting. In addition to the petrels, albatross, skuas, terns, gulls, and other seabirds, we observed many of the Heard Island cormorant, which is indigenous to this island. The little white chicken-like sheathbill is strongly attracted to lights at night, so we had to be quite careful to protect it from this danger. It's almost impossible to not take pictures of the penguins. This is the king penguin. There are most of a million of these on Heard Island. They're very tame, very curious. A friend wrote a book about penguins in which he said there are two kinds, the white ones coming toward you and the black ones going away from you. The radio operation was a major effort during the expedition. Up to six stations were used 24/7, making contact with thousands of operators worldwide.
Okay, whiskey, ECMO, five papa, five and nine.
All right, that'll be whiskey, three, kilo, extra, and your 5-9.
It's recording. You want to say something to the camera? It's right there.
Hi guys, how's it going?
Okay, fine.
Let's yep.
Not much.
Heard Island.
Here is in total disarray. That's fine. Thank you.
Can say anything you want.
What camera is that?
This one right here.
I'm all good.
Okay, see you guys.
See you guys. Thanks. This will never be on the website.
Oh right. Oh.
My pleasure. Best wishes from her. QSL B59 from Victor Echo 1.
Juliet Mike 1, Canada Mike Alpha 59. Thank you, 73QZ. Juliet Tango 8, Charlie Radio Alpha 59. Thank you, 73QZ. Italy Zulu 4, Delta Papa Victoria 59.
That's it. Give us a smile.
Ramon, it's Jim, N6TQ. You're 5'9".
Okay, Japan 1 November, go ahead.
Okay, it's Radio Charlie Honolulu, but I need the prefix. Japan, America, question mark, Radio Charlie Honolulu. Please copy, DK0EK, give me your call. Okay, Japan, America 6, Radio Charlie Honolulu, 5x9, QSL.
I am operating radio with Victor Kilo Zero Echo Kilo, and also doing some science out around the island. The main project that I've been working on is using a gigapan camera to take extremely high resolution panoramic images. Oh, this has been a great time. I'm sorry we have to leave so soon. I'd love to spend another few weeks here. I think we have a few days longer, but it's not very much, especially given the weather constraints.
I think that that's sort of the boundary of this most recent terminal moraine. And in fact, I wouldn't be surprised if there's ice under some of this stuff. I see that as just the toe of the glacier. And it's rock covered.
Right.
But it's the toe of the glacier with ice under it. And so these streams coming out are simply the subglacial streams coming out of the subglacier.
Right. Those streams are then sampling materials under there, and so what's carried in the water would be indicative of something further upstream.
Well, we're about to leave Lawrence Peninsula. It's been a really awesome four or five days up here. Well, that's the Lawrence Peninsula done for me. Just closed up the Apple and heading on down to the lagoon. We've got a boat picking us up hopefully in about 30 minutes. So yeah, got to be down at the lagoon and hopefully they can get through that surf. Surfed up a bit since yesterday, so we've got all our gear down there. And I just got to get myself down there. Fred's already gone. So collect last samples on the way through. And that's it for Lawrence. Next stop, Spit Bay, hopefully.
We found that the debris on Heard Island was derived from three principal sources. Objects that are derived from the research station that was abandoned more than 50 years ago, objects that float in from the open ocean, and objects that are derived from the natural environment. There is, in fact, not much plastic debris on Heard Island. We have evidence that indicates that the circumpolar current acts as a sweeper to prevent plastics originating in lower latitudes, the mid-Pacific for instance, from reaching the subantarctic islands and Antarctica. Heard Island is truly a boneyard, but these aren't fossils. It only takes a few days for a carcass to be turned into a skeleton. The glaciers supplied water for innumerable streams which had, over time, cut their own drainage channel. Walking in these channels was easier than on the rocks, in no small part because the soft moss provided for an easier step.
Now, I get a little upset when they see I'm coming the other way, but I need to keep moving or else I'm not going to catch my boat. Usually I'd just back off and let them through. There's a couple of mum and a couple of pups over there, but a couple of times I've been walking along and just haven't noticed them. Here we go, last look out over Lawrence Peninsula. Such an amazing place. We've got Gentoo penguins up behind us here. Up on the tops of those plateaus are the giant petrels. Way in the distance over there, you can see the white, there's some king penguins, a rookery with some chicks. Right on the far side, there's a rock hopper and macaroni penguins. In the middle here's another Gentoo colony, and out towards the end of the lagoon is cormorants, and all along the beach is the seals. So hopefully we'll get one last look at them as we head on out now.
We had intended to use the drone to do aerial surveys of the animals and the plants, but the permit didn't allow that. Surely a major missed opportunity. The Southern Cross, seldom seen by northerners. Aurora Australis, also seldom seen by northerners. Shadows of huge rocks on the far side of the mountain. Red light from a low sunrise. The setting sun sets the clouds ablaze. An enhanced rainbow, nearly on the ground. And an endless variety of clouds, created by unseen turbulent air.
This is Bob. I'm very happy to report that we succeeded in getting into the Stevenson Lagoon, going in at Spit, the south end on Spit Bay. It was calm inside. We We led an inspection of the shoreline, including glaciers, collected samples of the water and of the shoreline on the opposite, on the east side of. Then we used the bottom grab from the geological survey and obtained a sample of the sediment bottom in the lagoon. All the samples, not in the volume, but the diversity that we had planned to get from Snooker. So, great big success. It was a huge effort, but it went extremely well. Talk later, bye.
The far end of the island, an entrance to a large lake, unexplored and unsampled. A glacier, 3/4 of a mile across, but unnamed. The edges of the glacier are falling apart. The rocky surface falls as the ice under it collapses and melts. The ice falls away almost vertically. Its deep blue color confirms its great age. All that is left of the glacier that has melted to form the lake. The rotational motion of the ice shows in its terminus. The ice is clear, hard, and very, very old. The first specimens, plants, soil, and water, are collected and preserved. And we look upward. During the 3 weeks we were on the island, we visited 3 major locations, examining the rocks and the water, taking photographs, and making collection of specimens. These came back to the laboratory together with the water samples. All of the rock samples went to the University of Tasmania. Here's a couple of them. This is a strongly weathered basalt and a vesicular basalt. Here is some sand that's about 1 millimeter diameter. Here is some subhedral olivine crystals, an unidentified plant fragment, the wingless fly Anatalanta aptera, the starfish Anisterius masoni, the limpet Nacella kerguelenensis, seen in dorsal and ventral views. The expedition involved an enormous amount of documentation and communication. It began with the general website and with the agreement for participation in the expedition. The cover of the project description document and one version of the pages inside that document. One of 7 scientific proposals, the risk management plan, the application for the permit to visit Heard Island, and the actual permit, which was about 20 pages. Underway, we were monitored by the reverse beacon network, The radio operations were updated on a separate website with a help desk. Each day we filed written reports with the Australians, and the real-time activities of the radio were monitored on another website. We recorded audio logs, updated Facebook, updated Twitter, and finally we needed a permit to take the specimens off of the island, and we could start writing articles for radio and scientific magazines. Still a lot of work to do, and the work goes on. The last leg on the expedition would be to move from Heard Island to Fremantle, Western Australia, and from there home. The day before we left, we took the team's portrait in front of Big Ben. And the next day, most of the team posed in front of the completely clean camp. We left absolutely nothing. The last to leave the island would be Australian Alan Cheshire, who carried the Australian flag on and off. We made our entry into the Heard Island visitor log, which dates back to 1953, and the ship continued its daily log of sailing and operations. A team of 14 men included one from Switzerland, one from Ukraine, two from Australia, and the rest Americans. In Fremantle, the Braveheart's owner joined the crew, the vessel, and his son, the skipper. Eventually, the final report was submitted to the Australian Antarctic Division. It comprised 264 pages, 710 photographs. The last consideration, of course, is to the persons and organizations who supported this project, to whom we extend our sincere thanks.